name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we come before the throne of grace this morning. We recognize you, Lord, as our God and our Father. We thank you for who you are to us. Thank you for loving us, Lord, unconditionally. Thank you for being a wonderful Father and a good, good Father. We just want to raise our arms this morning, Lord, in exhortation to your name. Because, Lord, indeed, there is no God like you. Indeed, there is no one else quite like you, our Maker. May we just raise our hands and just honor the Father this morning. We thank you, Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ. We recognize your Lordship, Jehovah, even this morning in Jesus' name. We thank you, Jehovah, that you are seated on the throne and you reign supreme, O God, above authorities, above principalities, above rulers in the dark world. Thank you, Lord, that you reign supreme. You are God Almighty. You are the one who was, the one who is, and the one who is to come. You are the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Jehovah, the Holy One, is your name. You reign even in this house, oh God, you reign in our lives. We recognize you, Jehovah, as our God and our Father. We recognize your Lordship, Jehovah, even in this house this morning. We acknowledge your majesty. Riba kayan derebo sata le debre keleze bo yan derebo shata riba kasata tata karebe kesete. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Jehovah, you are God. We exalt your name, O Lord. You are worthy, my Father. You are worthy. You are worthy to receive all honor. You are worthy to receive all glory, all power, all praise belongs to you, Jehovah, because you and you alone, O God, are God. We honor you, King of Glory. We bow before your throne. We honor you, Jehovah. You are God. Be thou exalted in this house. Be thou exalted, O Father God, in Jesus' name. As we share the word this morning, our Father, we pray that you would lead us, O Jehovah. May you speak to us, O God. Your word says the eyes of many look unto you, and we give them all their food in due season, O God. May you meet each one of us, O God, at our point of need. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we pray. Thank you, Lord God Almighty. In Jesus' name we pray. May we give the Lord a hand of praise. Greetings, beloveds, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. I can't hear the church. Young people, are you here? Greetings, young people, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Greetings, church, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let me recognize Melera Lesego together with the church board. I also want to recognize Pastor Tosa and his wife and greet them in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Congregation at large, be greeted in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let me also start by thanking the leadership of this church for according us this opportunity to have a youth week. It's a time where we are able to express ourselves. It's an opportunity for us to grow so that they can also see that they are raising people that can be able to carry on with the baton as time goes on. For this pleasant opportunity. We had a beautiful time, as Murtis Hosa has already alluded to that. On Thursday, we had the official opening of the Youth Week, and then on Friday, we had a discussion with Tapamba Supi. He's a young missionary who is based in Nairobi, Kenya. He went into missions at a tender age of 23, and for almost 10 years now, he has been a missionary. Initially, he went to Malawi, and then he was based in Molepolole for a while, and then he moved to South Africa, and this year, he moved to Kenya. If you have not had an opportunity to listen to that conversation, you may want to visit the AFM Mogoditsane Youth Church page or the Mogoditsane AFM page and just listen to that conversation. It was quite an insightful one. So the theme for the Youth Church this year is Arrayed Relentless. And as once we have been enlisted in the army of the Lord, we are ready for battle. We are arrayed in a way that is ready to defend the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. We are not going to back down. We are showing no abatement in terms of severity, in terms of pace, in terms of intensity. We are not backing down on the assignment that God has given us. And we are saying that we are going to march forward and press towards the mark of a higher calling, regardless of the circumstances that we find ourselves in, regardless of the amount of opposition that we may face. We are saying as young people that we are marching forward, we are pressing forward. There is nothing that is going to stop us from fulfilling the mandate for which God has called us. And the theme for this Youth Week specifically is at all cost. And our key scripture is 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 1. I'm just going to read it. The Bible says, therefore, since through God's mercy we have received this ministry, we do not lose heart. Since through God's mercy we have received this ministry, we do not lose heart. What is this ministry we are talking about? It is well explained in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 14. The ministry to spread the aroma of God's love, to spread the knowledge of the Christ everywhere. That is the mandate for which God has called us. So this morning I'm going to be preaching on a message that is entitled, At All Cost. We are just going to maintain the theme and the title of the sermon is, At All Cost. Now before I go any further, I'd like to ask you a question or two that I want you to meditate on as we proceed with the message. What is this gospel worth to you? What is this gospel worth to you? What is it worth to you to fulfill the purposes for which God created you? What is it worth to you to become the person that God created you to be? And what is it worth to you to see the world reconciled with God? Because children of God, if you look at the gifts that the Lord has given us, if you look at the talents that the Lord has given us, if you look at our abilities, the different callings and the different gifts by the Holy Spirit, they all build towards the same thing, reconciling men with God. At the end of the day, everything that we are supposed to be doing is about bringing souls to Christ. Jesus Christ died so that the world may be reconciled with God. He died to restore man's relationship with God. Now, I'm going to make reference to the life of the Apostle Paul as we look into the message of At All Cost. The Apostle Paul is a man who devoted himself to God wholly. He had an encounter with God that changed his life forever. And after that encounter, he gave himself to God without reservations. He gave himself to God without holding back. He went in fully without leaving anything behind. And I want us to look at him because I think he's a good example of what it is to serve God at all cost. It is a good example that denotes what it is to serve God without reservations, without holding back on anything. Now, after his encounter with the Lord, the Apostle Paul started preaching the gospel to the Gentiles. He started reaching out to people that were not reached because of the encounter he had with the Lord on his way to Damascus. Now, there's something interesting that I want us to see in Colossians chapter 1, verse 23 and 25. The Bible says, if you continue in your faith established and firm and do not move from the hope held out in the gospel, this is the gospel that you heard that has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven, of which I, Paul, have become a servant. That is the key word I want us to look at. The gospel of which I, Paul, have become a servant. And then verse 25 says, I have become its servant by the commission God gave me to present to you the word of God in its fullness. Now, the Apostle Paul, after encountering the Lord, after having a confrontation with the Lord on his way to Damascus, he switches from one extreme to the other. This is a man who was at one point being persecuted, who was at one point persecuting the church for preaching the gospel. But here we see him saying that he has become a servant of this very gospel. What does it mean to be a servant of something? What does it mean to be a servant of someone? A servant is one who is subject to, who is under the control or the direction of another. Now we see the Apostle Paul laying down everything that he has ever prided himself in to become subject to this gospel. We see him taking this gospel as his master to the extent that nothing else in his life matters except the preaching of this gospel to the Gentiles, to people who do not know God. And as I look at life of the Apostle Paul, he says in Philippians, I think it's chapter 2, that, you know, I have a lot of things that I can have confidence in as a person. He was circumcised on the eighth day. That is something that they used to pride in. He was a Hebrew of the Hebrews. He was of the tribe of Israel. He was a Benjamite. And he was a Pharisee. He made sure that people stood for the law. And according to the law, if you were to assess him by the law, the Bible says he'd find himself faultless in terms of the law. Now, this man had so much that he was going to pride himself in. He had so much that he was going to boast about in his life. But the moment he comes face to face with the Creator, he considers all this garbage. The Bible says, he says, I consider this garbage. Let us read that in Philippians chapter 3, from verse 7 to 10. The Bible says, but whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ. Because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. Underline those words. Because of the surpassing worth of knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord, and for whose sake I have lost all things. And then he goes on to say, I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through the faith in Christ Jesus, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. Now verse 10 says, I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his suffering, becoming like him in his death. Hallelujah. Now, this is the man who was at one point persecuting the church. This is the man who was at one point punishing people who were proclaiming Christ. And all of a sudden, he has an encounter with this God. After this encounter, he wants to consider everything garbage. The Apostle Paul says, because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ. The next question I'd want to ask you from that is, what value have you attached to this Christ? Who is he to you? The apostle says, because of the surpassing worth of knowing him, that means there is nothing more important in his life than knowing Christ. And he has to strip himself of everything. In his case, it was everything that was done right in his upbringing, his career, and having been a Benjamite, having been an Israelite, having been a Hebrew of Hebrews, having been all that. So it was something that he would pride himself in. As I'm speaking to you now, introspect on the things that you pride yourself in. When I was growing up in Botswana, we had the 8 major tribes. I know that it has since been flushed off, but we know that there was a time when people would pride themselves in being among the 8 major tribes. Is it something that you hold so dear? What is it that you hold so dear to the extent that you are not willing to let it go for the sake of this gospel? The Apostle Paul says, for whose sake I have lost everything. For the sake of Christ, he has lost everything. And he switches from one extreme to the other. From being the one who has been persecuting the church to being the one who's been persecuted for the sake of the gospel. I'm just reminded right now of a time when the Holy Spirit told him that he was going to be persecuted if he went to a certain city. But the Bible records that he proceeded and went to that city anyway. Yet God had told him, what are you willing to lose for the sake of this gospel? What are you willing to suffer for the sake of fulfilling the mandate that God has created you for? To what extent are you going to go to fulfill the assignment that God has called you for? Is there anything in your life that you consider more important than the knowledge of the Christ? Is there anything you consider more valuable to you than knowing Christ? As I'm speaking right now, I want you to introspect on that. The Apostle Paul says, I want to fellowship in the cup of your suffering. Are we ready to fellowship in the cup of the Lord's suffering? Most of us Christians, it's easy for us to praise God when everything is going right. We have become a generation of I receive. We want to receive a good job. We receive a wonderful house. We receive everything good. We just want to come to God. As long as we are on the receiving end, it's fine. But how many of us are willing to suffer for the sake of this gospel? Why do you want to become the I receive generation? What are we going to do for God in this time and season? God is going to reach people on earth, but he's not going to be able to do that without you. He will need you to make the necessary sacrifices to be able to reach people through you. He says, I want to fellowship in the cup of your suffering. Are we willing to fellowship in the cup of the Lord's suffering? Or do you want only the brighter side? Do you want him when things are working out perfect for us? Or are we prepared to hold on to this course, even when it's uncomfortable, even when it's painful? Now, the question that comes to my mind right now as I'm looking at the life of the Apostle Paul, I wonder what it is he knew about God that we don't know. Why was his conviction about this God so strong? What did he see on his way to Damascus that caused him to have such a massive shift in his life, in his identity, in everything that he ever stood for all his life? I'm inclined to believe that the value and the worth we attach to Christ is directly and positively correlated to our revelation of him. Now the question is, has he revealed himself to you? Do you know him? Do you know this God? Everything shifted when he had an encounter with God. What does he know about Christ that we are yet to discover? What did he see in him that we have not seen? You know, not just the Apostle Paul, when you look at the early church, you will realize that these are the people who had devoted themselves wholly to God. I'm going to look at the example of Stephen shortly. But before we go there, let's read Galatians chapter 1, verse 13 to 16. It says that, these are the words of the Apostle Paul. He says that, for you have heard of my previous way of life in Judaism, how intensely I persecuted the church of God and tried to destroy it. I was advancing in Judaism beyond my own age among my people and was extremely zealous for the traditions of my fathers. Listen to verse 15. But when God, who set me apart from my mother's womb and called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his son in me. God was pleased to reveal his son in me so that I might preach him among the Gentiles. My immediate response was not to consult any human being. Now, when God revealed Christ to the Apostle Paul and gave him an assignment to preach him to the Gentiles, the Bible says his immediate response was not to consult any human being. I'm just here thinking that sometimes when young people come to us and they say, I feel the Lord is calling me to do this, the Lord is calling me in that direction, what are we inclined to say to them? Most of the times we tell them, you are still young, find a job, find stability, get a house, get something, you'll go into ministry at a later time in life. Sometimes we tell them, no, not now, are you sure you have heard him right? We find ways to discourage them from pursuing the mandate. Why? Because at the back of our minds, we feel that if a young person who seems to have a bright future forsakes everything to go preach the gospel, they are wasting their lives. That is the perception we have. Now, it goes back to the question I was asking, who is this Christ to you? Do we have a revelation of who he is? Because the moment we understand who he is, the moment we have a revelation of who Christ is, then we understand that there's no cost too high. If the gospel is not worth dying for, then it is not worth living for. Are you prepared to die for the gospel? Are you prepared to put your life on the line for the sake of this gospel, to fulfill the mandate that God has given you? Let's go to Acts chapter 6. Okay, let me not read it. It's a very long chapter. Chapter 6 and chapter 7. It is the story of Stephen, how he was called to come and assist the apostles. The Bible says in the beginning of chapter 6 that they were instructed to look for men who were full of the Spirit of God. And that is the basis on which Stephen was appointed among those who were going to preach the gospel. And they were now given tasks to assist the apostles as they continued with the assignment. And the Bible shows in chapter 7 that Stephen was working in miracles. He was very, rather instrumental in the house of the Lord. Now, during that time when he was serving with all his heart, working signs and wonders, they connived against him. They had him brought before the Sanhedrin. And then ultimately, they got him sentenced to death by stoning. Now, the Bible says when Stephen opened his eyes, he raised his eyes and he saw God. And when he saw God, that is the last verse of chapter 7. We can read that one. That's verse 59. It says that while they were stoning, Stephen prayed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Then he fell on his knees. Okay, verse 56, he says, "Look," he said, "I see the heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." Now, after he had been sentenced to death, when they wanted to stone him to death, he saw the heavens open. He saw the Son of Man standing at the right hand of the Father. And when he saw that, his current circumstances all of a sudden did not matter. Immediately did not matter to him what they were going to do to him. That's why at the end of chapter 7, he says, "Lord, do not hold this thing against them." But this man was serving God fully with his whole heart, devoted to God. But unfortunately for him, he is sentenced to death because they connived against him. I'm here wondering what a modern day Christian would have done, what a modern day Christian would have said, or how they would have responded to this situation. Because most of the times we, like I said earlier, we want things to work out for us. I imagine them saying, "Lord, all I've done is serve you. I've been committed to you. I've been doing everything you wanted me to do. Why is this thing happening to me? Are you even there?" But Stephen is not quick to point fingers at God. While in those circumstances, he raises his eyes and he sees the Son of Man standing at the right hand of the Father, and he smiled. He knew that he was going home. What worth do we attach to this gospel? If we knew its worth, trust me, we would not be reluctant to do what God is calling us to do. Now, Stephen is among the many matters of faith. Even the Apostle Paul, he was beheaded for the sake of the gospel. They cut off his head. The many apostles in the Bible, a lot of them died in horrible ways. Some were put in hot oil. Some were crucified upside down because they said, "I'm not worthy to be crucified like my master Jesus." And they said, "If you're going to crucify me with my head down," because of the revelation of who the Christ is to them. Who is this Jesus to you? Now, as I drive towards the conclusion, my desire is to know God. I don't know who is with me in that. I desire that the Lord would reveal himself to me in a way that is beyond reasonable doubt. Because I am strongly convicted that if you could have a revelation of this Christ so deep, then nothing is going to be more important to us than him. I am convicted that if the moment we get to know God, the moment we attach the value to the gospel that we should attach to it, then there is no cost that is going to be too high. There is no cost that is going to be too high. And I'm strongly convicted that if we allow ourselves to come before the Lord and ask him to reveal himself to us, that will be the breaking of revival. We need to see God. We need to have him reveal himself to us. We need to have a revelation of the things that matter to him. We need our hearts to beat at the same pace with his heartbeat. We need to be in sync with what God is doing in this time and season. When you look at the famous speech of Nelson Mandela, the 3-hour famous speech, the last sentence of that speech where they quote most of the times, it says, it is the same ideal for which I am prepared to die. Nelson Mandela fought for the liberation of the black people, and he was prepared to die in the struggle. What is our position? What is our conviction? The Lord is building an army for the last days. The Lord is building people that are going to be partakers in the revival that will break forth in the last days. Are you going to be a part of that army? Are you prepared to partake in what the Lord is doing in this time and season? Are you prepared to let go of everything and the things that you consider important for the sake of fulfilling that which God is calling you to do? What is this gospel worth to you? What is this gospel worth to you?